Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents California Exposures, Envisioning Myth and History, by Richard White and Jesse Amble White, read by Charles Constant. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to photographs present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. This book is a collaboration between a historian and a photographer who happen to be father and son. Relations between the present and past are fraught, but so too are relations between fathers and sons. We do not necessarily agree on the work a photograph can do. Jesse White has no illusion that his photographs are simple slices of reality. He selects, he frames, he alters, and he reacts. He regards a photograph as an artifact of a moment, a captured slice of time that was different before the now often metaphorical shutter clicked and will change again the second after it clicked. I do not deny that this is true, but I also think, as I will explain, that every photograph reveals a history because every element in the frame existed before the photograph and long before the photograph. Starting from a photograph, I can tell a story of a place by attaching the elements of the photograph, trees, buildings, land, animals, roads, levees, and more, to documents in archives, books, other photographs, maps, and memories. Our work focuses on three places with remnants of a fourth. In moving back and forth from place to place, I use the photographs to tell stories. When I stitch the stories together, the result is a montage that is also a history, a peculiar and very partial history of California. D Ranch on Point Reyes, the Tulare Lake Basin, and the lands of the co-joined San Gabriel and San Fernando missions are not the usual vantage points for writing a history of California. None of them, except perhaps the missions, are iconic, but all of them are revealing. As I deciphered the photographs, I began to realize that they are like tree rings in that big events and trends have left traces on them. It's the easiest to define the book by what it is not. It is not a photography book, although the photographs are its center, and without them there would be no book. It's not an art history book, which would focus more narrowly on the photographs themselves and on the photographer. Nor is it a conventional history, for in no histories that I know does the narration proceed from the photographs. Usually photographs illustrate the historical text. They are decorative. The book can be as a collage, but I intend the collage to function like the frames of a graphic novel, whose illustrations are an intrinsic part of the narrative. I would like to claim R. Crumb's Short History of America as an inspiration, but I cannot, since I looked at it carefully only when this book was nearly complete, though I claim it as an analogy. I put photographs at the center because I am pursuing a particular way of looking and seeing. I want to see the past in the present. I do not mean in museums, although Jesse took some of the photographs in museums. I do not mean at historical sites or in archives, although Jesse has photographed historical sites, and I have spent considerable time in archives. I mean seeing the past in plain sight, in the quotidian places where we live, work, and travel. People cannot recognize the importance of the past, of a history, if they cannot see it and recognize how pervasive it is. If this sounds like proselytizing, then so be it. I have spent my adult life teaching and writing about history in ways that now often seem quixotic. History has become less and less important in the schools and in public discourse and public policy. It seems irrelevant to daily life, even as I cannot imagine daily life without it. We ignore at our peril the dead who walk among us, jostle us, constrain us, and enable us. Traces of the dead surround us. The dead have made things, broken things, planted things, and killed things. The sum total of their actions and thoughts, along with what we have added and what nature has provided, constitutes our world. Our societies, economies, politics, and cultures are composed mostly of what the dead have done. We, like our world, are their progeny. Subtract the works of the dead, and the world would be diminished and unrecognizable. This is why history matters. Without history, we are strangers in a strange land, never understanding what we are seeing and unable to grasp how it came to be there. In everyday life, the past remains visible. It not only can be photographed, but virtually every photograph of our contemporary world is a historical photograph. Why? the photographer's arrangement of the elements of the past, as Jesse insists, might be of the moment and vanish the instant it is captured, but the elements themselves endure for varying amounts of time. These elements are fragments of once more complete pasts. They lead away from their present configuration and into the past, into earlier and different configurations. But if the past is everywhere in our lives, why not just look around? Why do we need photographs? We need them because photographs allow us to concentrate. They corral our attention away from the flux of vision that is always rushing us on to the next scene. This book is an extended exercise in expanding a lived experience and recovering context. The lived experience, more unconventionally, includes my own. This is not the first time I have encountered many of the places in this book. History is just one way that humans approach the past. Memory is another. The personal does not belong in all histories, but I think it belongs in this one. I have several techniques not wholly compatible for using photographs. Some are more elliptical than others. I excavate, I dismember, and I associate. What I do with the photograph determines how a chapter unfolds. When I excavate, I usually concentrate on digging down into a particular place. In others, I follow the references I find in the image. I can move far from the site of a given photograph. Just as Jesse sometimes employed a drone to take a photograph, sometimes my views can hover above the photograph's subject as I seek a panoramic view. The result is that the chapters, like photographs, are not all of a kind. The asymmetry arises from the technique. The premise of my excavation is that a modern photograph represents the temporal top layer of a sedimentary construction that extends below it. I am engaging in a kind of historical archaeology without the shovels. Going through the sediments yields a history. The logic is spatial, and the goal is to recover what was on the site of the photograph at various times in the past. For this, I often use old maps as well as old photographs and contemporary descriptions. No sedimentary layer is pure. All around us are erratics, as geologists call deposited materials transported by glaciers from somewhere else. Space, the site captured in the photograph, always reflects time. When viewers concentrate on a particular space, they inevitably move backward in time. My second technique, dismemberment, approaches a photograph the way a coroner approaches a corpse. Dismembering a photograph isolates and explores a single element or group of elements. Coroners use parts of the body or alien objects present in the body to construct a larger story, a history of what turned a body into a corpse. The disease, the bullet, the split cranium, all point to things beyond the body itself. Similarly, isolating and following the elements in a photograph can carry me to other places and to people connected to but separate from the places I am describing. I find these elements compelling because no matter how wispy they might seem, the photograph led me to them. Dismembering thus leads to the third technique, association. Association often connects me to previous attempts to understand and shape California's past. I have found that I am hardly the first person to think that I can see the past. Americans have not only told stories about California almost as soon as they arrived, but they have preserved the past, recreated the past, memorialized the past, pictured the past, and reenacted the past. All of these activities claim a visualized past in order to shape a future. The mythic stories of California are like the fogs at Point Reyes, where this book begins. They can seem to obscure the actual landscape until you realize they are parts of the landscape. Organization. Taken together, the chapters proceed roughly chronologically, as most histories do, but within chapters, time bounces around. Each chapter begins in the present, or rather the near past, the moment the metaphorical shutter clicked, before darting off into various sectors of the past. The guides to the narrative's path are the brief introductions of each part. I fully recognize that in harnessing photographs to history, I need to hold the reins tightly. These powerful images would just as readily pull the narrative along as myth, by which I mean timeless stories that differ from history. My first section is an examination of myths, and I do not use myth pejoratively. Myths are not so much falsehoods as explanations. Myths, as Richard Slotkin has written, are representations that collapse into a single emblematic story the assumptions and values of a culture. History and myth both aspire to tell why things and people are the way they are. But where historical stories tend to be particular, contingent, and relatively open-ended, anything can happen, myths seek universal meanings and claim to explain why things have to be how they are. The very framing, and thus meaning, of landscape photographs is mythic. Wide open spaces, men to match the mountains, home sweet home. Once a myth makes a photograph its host, the line between myth, an explanation, and reality, what it explains, nearly vanishes. While writing this book, I began to recognize that the three mythic stories about the origins of California that appear in the book's photographs, Sir Francis Drake and Discovery, the Mission Myth, and the Gold Rush Myth, are all just variants of a larger Anglo-Saxon myth of California that is remarkably hard to shake. It is the myth of the preordained white man, the idea that California always awaited the white men who would give the state its proper form. Another set of myths belongs to Native California. They revolve around the character known as Coyote. My goal in examining these myths is not to debunk them, but to historicize them, treating them as consequences rather than causes. The first three parts of this book examine myths and then yield to parts focusing on property and capital. Their chapters usually concern the simultaneous process of dividing and allocating land and the new connections that the movement of people and capital forge between what has been severed. The last parts seek to reunite the myths and the culture they inform with the economic and social realities of modern California. Here the span between the taking of the photographs and the pasts they reveal are foreshortened. This book began as a wager between Jesse and myself. I bet I could turn his photographs into a history of California. I have lost the bet. What follows is too partial to be a complete history. The book is more a proof of concept than the complete history of California I envisioned. The time and topics that the book covers are critical, but they are not complete. I touch on the state's deep racial divisions, but Watts, for instance, lies outside the frame. I spend time on technological innovation, but Silicon Valley, where I teach, lurks only around the edges. The rise and rapid decline of the state's educational system and Proposition 13, which precipitated the decline, receive only glancing mention in the book. The state's frequently peculiar politics sometimes enters the story, but more often does not. The photographs led me to pursue five themes. The first is the mythic structure of California, the California dream, that California politicians still refer to. The second is environmental transformation, for better or worse, which accelerated rapidly with American conquest and whose consequences pose immense challenges today. The third is California's self-image as a land of individualists and its reality as a creature of the state, both the state and federal governments. The fourth is the hybrid nature of the place, not only in its environment but in its population. That today California is a majority-minority state with no single racial or ethnic group forming a majority was not inevitable, but it was foreshadowed in the 19th and early 20th centuries. California's American history began in 1848 when the United States annexed Mexican territory, and more than any other part of the United States, California has grasped the Pacific and Central and South America as essential to its identity and future. It is no wonder that Asian and Latino immigrants and their descendants form such a large proportion of the state. The fifth theme is the dynamism of the California economy, which began less with the gold rush than the agricultural developments of the 19th and early 20th centuries. Economic promise and individual opportunity have been hallmarks of the California dream since the gold rush, but large periods of the state's history have been marked by dangerous levels of economic inequality. I may have lost the wager with Jesse, but few bets have proved more profitable to me. I am astonished at what a photograph can reveal. I do not have to pretend that it reveals everything. In California, as elsewhere, history will never displace myth and memory. Its goal is not to eliminate them, but to encompass them. Part 1. Drake's Dream. There is an old dory at Point Reyes National Seashore, lost among the weeds of D Ranch and decayed nearly to the vanishing point. I had passed it many times, but I did not really think about it until Jesse photographed it. It took a while, but the photograph reoriented me. It emphasizes the dory's slow decay, but Jesse framed the picture so that the boat points to the strip of sea between the land and sky in the background. The D Ranch sits on the edge of the continent. The boat decays, the sea endures. D Ranch had been a working ranch when its residents last used this boat. They took it to the sea and hauled it back to the ranch regularly until one day they no longer did so. The photograph made me wonder why they went to the sea and why they stopped. Photographs lead the viewer to wonder and ask questions about the spaces within the frame of the photograph. Those spaces have names. Those spaces have often been mapped. Many of the spaces where the sea abutted D Ranch had been named for Sir Francis Drake. I had no idea what strange stories these names contained. I was initially interested in where the dory was launched into the sea. By the time Jesse and I walked across D Ranch to Drake's Estero, Spanish for estuary, I was in search of Drake. Drake had landed on North America before Roanoke, before Jamestown, before Plymouth. In the 19th and 20th centuries, people attached great significance to his being the first Anglo-Saxon. To look for Drake was to encounter the Anglo-Saxons as the founders of California. Chapter 1. Is Seeing Believing? This photograph is the most convincing visual connection between Sir Francis Drake and D. Ranch. It is not much of a connection, nor did Jesse intend it to be. It is a sandy cliff along Drake's Bay. Jesse took it, I think, because the lines the water etched on the beach parallel those on the cliff, which disappears into the fog as it recedes into the background. Only later did I realize that these were presumably the cliffs Drake's crew said reminded them of the White Cliffs of Dover. Connections to Sir Francis Drake come easily when you're walking along a beach on Drake's Bay. To get to D Ranch, Jesse and I had driven down Sir Francis Drake Boulevard. We were walking to Drake's Estero, which supposedly contains Drake's Cove. If history had billboards at Point Reyes, they would all advertise Sir Francis Drake. But the advertising campaign is relatively recent. The names connecting Drake to Point Reyes officially appeared only in the late 19th century with the U.S. Coast Survey. In the 17th and 18th centuries, Drake's name was sporadically attached to the modern Drake's Bay, but was also applied to other sites. For a time in the 19th century, Drake's Bay was known as Jack's Bay, a name still attached to an inlet at its head. Nobody is looking for Jack, but Jesse and I were walking the beach below the cliffs because I had become the latest in a long line of people looking for Drake. One morning at the end of May 2014, the two of us left the old buildings at D Ranch to walk to Drake's Estero. The names had awakened questions about a ship that Drake had supposedly careened, that is, heaved down to expose its hull for repairs, near the site of the old hunting cabin at D Ranch. We were walking only a few miles, but we hoped to travel back roughly 4 centuries. We thought that if we could see what Drake had seen in June and July 1579, we could find him and his ship, the Golden Hind. We would, at least figuratively, see his ship as clearly as I saw the rowboat on D Ranch. Thinking about the dory and the things salvaged from shipwrecks had led me to the archives to find out how people got from D Ranch to Drake's Bay and to Drake's Estero. In 1997, the National Park Service mapped D Ranch, both as it was then and as it had been in the recent past. The dory had made its way to Drake's Estero on the back of a truck that the Horrocks, the last family to reside there, had driven along an old ranch road to the hunting lodge on the estuary. Neither the lodge nor an earlier nearby dock remained when the map was drawn. The map records the tail end of a watery past that began in the 19th century when ranchers sent their butter to San Francisco by ship. The hunting lodge was gone by 1973, the dock well before that. As we found out, by 2014, only traces of the road remained. Jesse and I were stragglers in the search for Drake. Since the late 19th century, historians and archaeologists, but mostly enthusiasts, have sought the spot where Drake careened his ship before continuing his journey around the world. I was a conflicted searcher. I didn't really care much about either Drake or the exact spot. I was more interested in why people had persisted in looking for him for so long, how they had searched for him, and the places they had gone. Convinced that beginnings are the most important thing about a story, I thought I could learn something about California and its history if I could understand why Californians had once started the story of the state with the arrival of Sir Francis Drake. Because the National Park Service had rather equivocally decided that he landed at Drake's Bay, and the Drake's Navigators Guild has proclaimed that this decision verified their claim that the exact spot was Drake's Cove on D Ranch, I started there. Virtually everybody known to have searched for Drake has found him, but they have all found him in different places. The oldest accounts mention his landing at both 38 and 34 degrees of latitude, creating a competition between California and Oregon. Many of the Californians in search of Drake claimed that the anchorage where the General had spent a month repairing the Golden Hind was in San Francisco Bay or Bodega Bay, but other claimants marked spots farther north and south. Even when they found him in Drake's Bay, they put the anchorage at different locations. Since everyone could not be right, they have quarreled bitterly, angrily, and sometimes hilariously. They have filled books, archival collections, and personal letters with their disputes. I think they are a little nutty. I also think that I have become one of them. Like them, I believe that we can see into the past. It is not gone. It is right in front of us. We can even capture it in photographs, which is why Jesse is along. He takes photographs. I know nothing about taking photographs. I specialize. I look. I am looking for something both more obvious and more elusive than Sir Francis Drake. I am looking for the origin of California, the imagined moment when 19th century Americans believed California began and the state's destiny spun out like a road before it. Drake was, they thought, the source from which all else followed. The boat in the weeds set us off on a long walk into the past. Portus Novae Albionis. Before Drake's Bay became Drake's Bay, Spanish explorers had given it various names, most notably the Bahia de San Francisco. The Miwok called it Tamal Hayi. Drake's Bay and Drake's Estero have elbowed their way onto modern maps by claiming to be Portus Novae Albionis, using the name Drake gave to the place he landed. Drake's Bay and Drake's Estero are today easy to find, but Drake's Cove demands some looking. It is not a cove. It has no water. It exists only in the past, if it even existed there. Drake was a painter as well as a privateer and a pirate, but none of his journals, logs, or paintings of the voyage have survived, nor do any of his maps remain, although it is credibly claimed that one of the insets, the one on the upper left-hand corner of the 1595 Jodocus Handius map of the world, is a sketch by Drake, or a member of his crew showing the harbor, Portus Novae Albionis, where the Englishman put in on the Pacific coast to repair his ship. Generations of searchers for Drake have amply demonstrated that it does not require a great deal of imagination to find the seal-headed harbor of the Handius inset in many places along the coast. George Davidson, the first American hot on the trail of Drake, acknowledged the flaws of the Handius inset. It had neither geographical position, scale, meridian, or soundings. It is destitute of any explanatory note. From its shape and the scale of the ship and surrounding, one is led to suppose that it is a small anchorage. As such, there is no harbor like it on the coast. And then he found that harbor. George Davidson had started mapping the California coast for the U.S. Coastal Survey in the early 1850s, and by the 1880s, he was writing the fourth edition of the United States Coast Pilot. Davidson looked like the sea captain that he was, and no sea captain knew the coast better than he did. As he became fascinated with Drake and sailed the R.H. Fauntleroy, a U.S. Coast Survey brig, over the very track Drake had pursued, his skepticism over the Handius inset diminished. In the 1850s, he thought Drake had entered San Francisco Bay, but 30 years later, he knew better. He concluded that Drake anchored in Drake's Bay just south of Drake's Beach, below the entrance to the estuary. How did he know? He saw it. He looked into the past. He saw the Portus Novae Albionis. He could almost point out the spot where he careened his ship. Having sailed where he thought Drake sailed, he saw what Drake saw. He had not the shadow of a doubt as to the exact locality. Some things did not change over centuries. The accounts of Drake's voyage mentioned the White Cliffs, which reminded the Englishmen of Dover and gave the harbor the name of New England, Portus Novae Albionis. Whether the cliffs look white or not depends on the light and perspective. In Jesse's photograph, they do not look white. On a sunny day from the distance, they are at least whitish cliffs, and Davidson saw those cliffs with his own eyes. Accounts of Drake's progress along the coast are sketchy and vague. By contrast, Davidson's description of the Englishman's route was full and detailed, because he was not really describing Drake's voyage in the 16th century, but rather his own in the 19th. Davidson wrote as if he were standing beside Drake. He was steering to the southeastward. He could already see the wooded sides of Tamalpais. He would also note the low, small black rock. Davidson was a skilled sailor, and Drake was a skilled sailor, so Drake must have done what Davidson would have done. Centuries vanished. The vague narrative gave way to the certainty of common experience. The place where 19th-century ships sought shelter from the strong summer winds must have been where Drake sought shelter. By calculating the place with the greatest shelter, under the northern shore of the promontory and farther than 5/8 of a mile from the eastern point, Davidson had the place where Drake hove down his vessel. Portus Novae Albionis was a geographical Rorschach test. Davidson browbeat his evidence, dismissing information that did not fit. When the old maps made in the wake of Drake failed to show any safe anchorage on the coast, it was, he concluded, because the mapmakers had missed the anchorage. It had been, he remarked, hard to discern until James Lawson's 1852-53 U.S. Coast Survey made the characteristics of this harbor of refuge fully known. By the 1940s, Davidson's site had become the landing of Consolidated Fisheries and a Coast Guard rescue station. Aubrey Neesham, a National Park Service archaeologist, took up Davidson's determination to shoehorn the site into the available evidence. Neesham suggested that a stone floor, which he had excavated, was not just the site of a 19th-century quarry, but the stone floor of Drake's fort. He dated an iron spike to Elizabethan times. He mentioned various artifacts, an anchor inscribed with the name Golden Hind, a 16th-century gun butt, and a 16th-century English coin as further signs of Drake's presence. All of these had disappeared. Neesham's credulity and liberality of interpretation alarmed and embarrassed Robert Heiser, a Berkeley anthropologist also fascinated with Drake. The Drake Navigators Guild. Drake's landing place kept moving during the 20th century. By the 1950s, the Drake Navigators Guild led the search. Raymond Acker was its leading light. Like Davidson and like me, Acker thought he could see into the past. In 1970, Acker compiled a massive research report which he updated in 1976. He gave it a suitably academic title, Report of Findings Relating to Identification of Sir Francis Drake's Encampment at Point Reyes National Seashore. His work is quite impressive. Acker was a brilliant and determined researcher who reprinted or cited much of what is known about Drake's California voyage. I envy his perseverance and talents. For nearly a century, academics and enthusiasts have combed archives in Europe, North America, and Central America for mentions of Drake's voyage. Drake straddled the always thin line between pirates, who robbed and plundered on their own account, and privateers, who robbed and plundered under a license from an empire or state. Neither group left many records. Drake had pillaged and murdered his way up and down the Pacific coast of Spanish America, from present-day Chile to Mexico, and the Spanish understandably wanted to catch the man and execute him. The Spanish did not treat those crew members who fell into their hands kindly. Torture does not produce reliable information. Given all this, what researchers found was astonishing, even if relatively little of it came directly from the hands of those who made the voyage. The two most important sources overlap in time: Richard Hakluyt's famous voyage, published in 1589, and The World Encompassed, published by Drake's nephew and namesake in 1628. These works contained many similar passages because they were largely derived from a single, now lost, source written by Francis Fletcher, chaplain on the Golden Hind. A different source, the anonymous narrative, or a discourse of Sir Francis Drake's journey and exploits after he had passed Ye Straits of Magellan, alone seems to come directly from a participant in the expedition. That account survives in the British Museum. there are also some memoranda, the testimony of Spaniards captured by Drake and later interrogated by Spanish authorities, as well as the testimony of John Drake, a cousin and crew member who was captured by the Spanish while he was on a later buccaneering voyage and was then persuaded to talk. There were records of Spaniards who went in search of Drake, but they found neither him nor any traces of his presence. Sebastian Rodriguez Cermeño wrecked his galleon on Limontour Spit, within sight of Drake's Cove in 1595, but he found no sign of Drake, his fort, or the plate he left behind to record his presence. Nor did Sebastian Vizcaíno, who entered Drake's Bay 8 years later, find any sign of Drake. Cermeño fixed what is now Drake's Bay at 38 degrees in 1595, but he called it Puerto, or Bahía, de San Francisco. 8 years later, Vizcaíno imposed new names to the bays around 38 degrees. Drake's Bay is either his Puerto de los Reyes or Puerto de Don Gaspar. After Vizcaíno, there is no record of Europeans entering the bay until 1793. Vizcaíno's charts vanished into the Spanish archives, to be resurrected around the turn of the 19th century and reproduced on the Carta Plana de los Reconocimientos Hechos por el Capitán Sebastián Vizcaíno. Cermeño and Vizcaíno had entered Drake's Bay when the signs of Drake's visit would have been most visible. They came into contact with Miwoks, who should have remembered him. Neither explorer found evidence that Drake had ever been there. The argument made by Drake Navigators Guild for Drake's Cove was not the first one, but it was the most detailed and most visual. In 1888, Kate Field, writing in Picturesque California, a volume edited by John Muir, located the landing at Limontour Bay, Drake's Estero, but she had to imagine the harbor. Acker and the guild photographed it. They surveyed the landscape in search of a place Drake could have safely careened a ship. This brought them to the estuary. They took photographs, comparing them to the engraving on the borders of the Handias insert of 1595. Acker, acting as a forensic sketch artist, rendered visible what was invisible on the modern landscape. Drake's Estero lacked three elements of the Handias engraving: an inlet shaped like a seal's head, an offshore island, and a long peninsula. Drake's Cove was only an expanse of sand with long-established vegetation. But a photograph taken on November 24, 1952, from a bluff on the west side of the estuary gave them a break. It revealed a resemblance between the inset and a small cove that formed when a sand spit emerged to create the seal head shape of the cove. The sand spit was transitory and no water covered the cove, but Acker reasoned that as fleeting as the spit and a sandbar offshore were, they were evidence of Handias's peninsula and island. Other guild members remained skeptical. They dug to find traces of Drake's fort, but found nothing. In 1952, the same year the guild took its photograph, the U.S. Department of Agriculture conducted an aerial survey of the Point Reyes Peninsula. The guild did not obtain the survey's picture of the cove until 1956. It fortuitously chanced to capture the entrance to Drake's Estero when its configuration was analogous to the inset view. A generous amount of latitude must be allowed to see in the sandbars of the 1952 photograph the equivalent of the Handias sketch. But there is a sandbar adjacent to the point at the entrance and another one offshore. The Handias inset, the guild decided, was not a sketch but a fairly accurate map projection. It had morphed from a crude decorative drawing without scale or cardinal directions into a map that must be strictly interpreted as a faithful view of his landing place as it appeared in 1579. Acker attributed those parts of the site that did not conform to the inset to the artistic liberty of the mapmaker. A long walk. To get to the place where the Drake Navigators Guild located Drake's Cove, Jesse and I should have followed the National Park Service map. Instead, we cut across coastal scrub and rangeland. The land is not the same as it was in the 16th century. Coastal scrub seems remarkably resistant to disturbance, but even it has been reshaped over the centuries. Americans suppressed Miwok fires, and Mexicans and Americans heavily grazed the land. Some patches were farmed. We had not gone far when I nearly stepped on a coyote. It was dead. Coyote was the central character in Miwok stories. Olema, the name of a small village at Point Reyes, is Miwok for coyote. Coyote was a trickster who could be tricked, and in some stories he dies, although never permanently. That day, Olema looked up at me with a death grin. He looked permanently dead to me. Coyote prefigured Drake. In the early 20th century, Maria Copas Frias, a Marin Miwok, told Drake's story to the anthropologist Isabel Kelly, except with Coyote as Drake. Coyote came from the west, where the sun sets. The old people think the dead go to the west because Coyote went back there. In Frias's story, transmutations and transformations followed. After our encounter with Coyote, we followed elk trails. The elk were not supposed to be on D Ranch. It is pastoral land. The elk were supposed to be in the wilderness section of the park on the other side of the estuary. Elk ignore signage, and they can swim. Like Coyote, elk were ubiquitous in Miwok stories. The elk called Coyote grandfather. In May of 2014, California was in the third year of drought. Late rains had produced patches of tall grass, wildflowers, and thistle among the scrub. The cattle had not yet been turned onto the ranch. We could see the elk in the distance. We had to circumvent a small two-forked and unnamed estuary, once blocked by a dam and weir that cuts the ranch. We crossed a brackish lagoon, and old tire stood upright within it. The mud was mixed with tar. When we reached the beach along the bay, it looked like a scene from a battle that Dungeness crabs had lost. Dismembered crabs were everywhere. Following the beach, we eventually arrived at the mouth of Drake's Estero, turned into it as Drake supposedly did, and looked for the cove, Drake's Cove. We walked into a picture-slash-map Raymond Acker had drawn that encapsulated his version of Drake's Landing. The Guild had kept taking and collecting photos that revealed a changing and ephemeral landscape. Sandbars emerged and disappeared. The ocean cut tidal sloughs, which were blocked only to reemerge. What they saw in this estuarial kaleidoscope was the landscape seen by Drake and his crew. Acker's account is disorienting, with surmise built upon surmise, and surmise morphing into fact. It is like watching plastic surgery. The landscape changes shape so it will conform to the Hondius inset. The reader becomes confused, but the writer never does. All those vectors, adjustments of scale, and correlations are possible because nothing is fixed or found on the actual landscape, which contains no cove, no fort, no remnant of Drake's actual presence. The landscape ultimately assumed the desired form in Acker's conjectural appearance of the Drake's Cove in the summer of 1579. He imposed the fort, the ship, the peninsula, and the spit onto a photograph of the cove taken in February 1955. As a strict interpretation of the Hondius map, the conjectural appearance does not pass muster. The fort in the inset does not match the fort in the conjectural reconstruction. It has been moved from the cove proper to the peninsula or sandspit. It sat beneath the bluff. Building a fort on a sandspit beneath an overhanging bluff might seem like an odd choice, although the Guild explains it with more vectors showing lines of fire, but it removed the necessity for the Guild to locate the fort or any remains of Drake's presence. All of it had washed away. Raymond Acker had spent years trying to find a place where everything he knew about Drake cohered, where he could look out and see Portus Novae Albionis. He imposed his gaze on an Elizabethan in his painting. Jesse and I stood in what Acker believed to be the cove. We were, in effect, the ship staring back at Drake's men on the bluff. Jesse took a photograph. Reconciling that photograph with Drake is not easy. Standing in Acker's picture, I could see no trace of the general, and neither for many years could the National Park Service or the California State Historical Resources Commission. The Drake Navigators Guild tried to get those groups to see. The Guild staked its faith in the power of anniversaries. Americans might not be enthusiastic about history, but they love anniversaries. The year 1979 marked the 399th anniversary of the landing of Sir Francis Drake somewhere on the Pacific coast, which meant that it was a launching pad for those seeking to commemorate the 400th anniversary of Drake's landing. The trick was celebrating at the right spot. The Guild wanted a State Historical Resources Commission plaque at Drake's Cove and Drake's Estero for the anniversary. Robert H. Power, the leading advocate for a rival site at San Quentin, regarded the Guild as a historical cult, and he demanded that the plaque be placed in San Francisco Bay. The guild members referred to Power, founder of the Nut Tree Restaurant, a landmark on the highway from San Francisco to Sacramento, as the chief nut from the tree and a purveyor of idiotic nonsense. To buttress the case for Drake's having landed at Drake's Estero rather than other sites promoted by other enthusiasts, the guild had, by the late 1970s, enlisted retired Admiral Chester Nimitz, the victor at the Battle of the Coral Sea. Admiral Nimitz had access to U.S. Navy vessels, and he agreed to take part in a short voyage on USS Tulare, arranged by the Drake Navigators Guild. The plan was to sail to three of the disputed sites. Even on a naval ship far too large to navigate any of the anchorages where Drake had supposedly landed, the Guild thought that seeing would lead to believing. It would convince any skeptics and the California State Historical Resources Commission that the true landing place was in Drake's Estero. Obtain the right vantage point, look with seamen's eyes, and the centuries would burn off like the fog to reveal Drake's true sight. The point of the cruise up the coast was to see the land as Drake would have seen it. At the time, Vivian Horrocks ran D Ranch, and since Drake's Cove lay just below the Horrock Hunting Lodge, the Guild invited the Horrocks on the voyage. It was a nice touch, having the present inhabitants of the ranch view the land as Drake supposedly saw it. It was worthy of Clio, the Greek muse of history, and Vivian Horrock responded in a perfect hand on a Clio note card, with roses on the cover. This was a nice pun, Clio and Clio, but I doubt the Horrocks intended it or anyone else recognized it. The Horrocks eventually had to decline. They hoped, however, to join the guild at Drake's Beach or at the hearings that followed the voyage. Drake had not much liked the stinkin' fogs of the coast, and nearly 400 years later, the fog again blanketed the area. The guild's voyage to see what Drake had seen was frustrated by thick fog that prevented anybody from seeing much of anything. The State Historical Resources Commission refused to take a position on the landing site. It was all very disappointing. Chapter 2. What Drake Meant. Jesse's photographs at D Ranch ultimately led me to San Francisco and the monument to Sir Francis Drake in Golden Gate Park. Intended to be visible for miles, the monument is hard to find. Monuments to Drake proliferated in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, but what once seemed obvious and important became obscured in a way captured by the photograph of the Celtic Cross in San Francisco. Jesse framed the photograph from the hillside looking upward. The photograph centers on the cross, as if the photographer has stumbled on an old gravestone in the woods. It is fitting that this monument is nearly invisible. In theory, monuments make history visible, notifying a visitor that here something happened. But such markers often don't record history, they record controversies. They are attempts in metal and stone to end an argument. They remain even after the argument has been lost. Episcopalians placed the monument in what was then the state's largest city, and they wanted it to be visible from ships entering the Golden Gate. It was the Episcopalians' third attempt at commemorating Drake. The first came at Davidson's site near Chimney Rock on Point Reyes, where in 1892 Episcopal Bishop Nichols planted a modest wooden cross. The next year, Episcopalians erected a far more elaborate Celtic cross there, with funds donated by George W. Childs, editor of the Philadelphia Ledger. It commemorated, the Sausalito News declared, our own Plymouth Rock, but few people went there. Even those who were willing to concede Chimney Rock as the literal place of Drake's landing recognized that San Francisco was a better figurative site of his arrival. In 1894, the Episcopalians erected a cross in Golden Gate Park that dwarfed the wooden one at Point Reyes. It was made of blue sandstone, and newspaper accounts claimed several of the stones in it are larger than the largest stone of the Pyramid of Cheops. It was designed as a sermon in stone, but it became a tourist site celebrating an Anglican pirate and the founding of California. The cross added a necessary Protestant element to Drake's landing, but this claim of Protestant triumphalism was not without problems. The monument was a figurative sermon to honor an actual sermon given by Francis Fletcher, the chaplain on the Golden Hind, considered by Drake the falsest knave that liveth, but what Fletcher preached was not known. That Drake was a pirate made the celebration of his religious faith incongruous, But the Episcopalians angrily denied this part of the story. When Hiram Johnson, the governor of California, innocently and absent-mindedly asserted it at a later commemoration ceremony near Point Reyes, the rector of St. Paul's Episcopal Church intervened to proclaim Drake the priceless possession of all English people. Johnson's response was the early 20th century equivalent of whatever. The point of the cross was less about the sermon than the association of Drake and the English with piety rather than piracy. Drake was religious. He was a praying, psalm-singing pirate who hoped the Indians would somehow become Anglicans. By stressing English sermon, the Episcopalians escaped the objection that there must have been Spanish sermons in the 1542-43 expedition of Juan Rodriguez Cabrillo up the California coast. Today, millions of motorists on Park Presidio Drive, part of the major route across the western part of San Francisco, pass within less than 100 yards of the cross. Few ever see it. Few visit it. Planting trees around the cross was not a good idea, nor was constructing it of sandstone. The engravings are fading. Some are gone. Those that remain are more than a century old, but their text sounds even more ancient. They celebrate Drake as first, the first Protestant, the first Englishman, the first missionary, on our coast, in our country, on our continent. The monument carries us back into a putative Anglo-Saxon America of the late 19th century. At a time of heavy immigration and deep worries about the racial identity of the state and the country, Drake shouldered the Anglo-Saxon burden. The beginning of California was white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, and peaceful. Indians bestowed their country on Englishmen and eventually just disappeared. The story persisted even as immigration transformed the country in the late 19th century and early 20th centuries. In the Los Angeles Times in 1930, George Wycherley Kirkman echoed the cross's claims, celebrating Drake as the first Anglo-Saxon to see California, the first English speaker, and the first booster who wanted to plant an English colony in the future state. Anglo-Saxonism had a gravity so strong that it sought to pull the actual Drake and the Golden Hind out of Drake's Bay and into San Francisco Bay. A subset of Drake enthusiasts insisted that he, not the Spanish, had discovered San Francisco Bay. Their arguments were clearer on what was at stake than on the supporting evidence. Destiny was preparing for an Anglo-Saxon America, they argued, and it would not have sent Drake into one of the region's worst anchorages when perhaps the best harbor in the world was a few miles away. As Robert Power, a former head of the California Historical Society and one of the leading advocates for San Francisco Bay as Drake's real landing place, wrote as late as the 1970s, "San Francisco Bay would have provided the English nation with a magnificent introduction to North America, warranting the poet Parmenius's words, 'Take up the standards, don't delay, and use your swift sails to go as fast as the winds allow.' Point Reyes, on the contrary, would have given the English nation a bleak introduction and would hardly have caused men to risk life or death to come back to North America," again quoting Parmenius, "to exercise authority in a worthy manner." In other words, Point Reyes was hardly worth a trip to California. But San Francisco was a destination to remember, even if Power had to quote a forgotten Hungarian poet to prove it. The very fact that Anglo-Saxons did come back a few centuries later meant Drake must have landed in San Francisco. The photograph of the existing cross speaks to an earlier photograph. The cross is constant, but most everything around it has changed. The budgies are gone. The trees have grown, and the cross that was meant to be visible from the Golden Gate and the Pacific has vanished behind the foliage. In its obscurity, the cross commemorating the founding of Anglo-Saxon California became a symbol of Anglo-Saxonism's decline. The crosses should have been a cautionary tale. They were not. In 1979, on the 400th anniversary of Drake's arrival and a year after the ill-fated voyage of the Drake Navigators Guild with Admiral Nimitz, the Sir Francis Drake Quadricentennial Committee placed a plaque above Drake's Beach. The beach runs northeast to southwest underneath the white sandstone cliffs of Drake's Bay, from just below the estuary down toward Chimney Rock and Drake's Head. Beyond is the Pacific Ocean. The Guild had asked both the Drake Committee established by the state and the National Park Service to name Drake's Cove a historical landmark with an appropriate plaque. but the state committee deadlocked and did not choose between the contested sites within Drake's Bay. Instead, it situated the plaque between them. Drake, the plaque proclaimed, had sailed into Drake's Bay on June 17, 1579, and sailed out on July 25th. He saw the white cliffs and named the place Nova Albion. He had claimed the region for Queen Elizabeth I, and was the first English commander to circumnavigate the earth. The plaque equivocated about the site, but not about Drake's significance. Drake's exploits and claim encouraged England to colonize Roanoke in 1585 and Jamestown in 1607. Captain John Smith, in 1616, named the east coast New England, a reflection of Drake's Nova Albion. Somewhere near this patch of California beach, between Chimney Rock and Drake's Estero, or so the claim went, the United States began. Drake inspired Sir Walter Raleigh to found Roanoke, which led to Jamestown and then New England, which led to the American Revolution, which eventually produced American expansion that came full circle to California. So, in the 19th century, the 49ers were not invaders. They were just coming home. Drake had gone from being an Anglican, and thus near Episcopalian, to being at least an honorary American. All this was pretty bold talk and a heavy burden to put on a pirate who spent a month on a beach supervising a crew patching a ship. Here come the Anglo-Saxons. The critical date on any monument is not the date of the event or person it commemorates, but its construction date, which tells you why it is significant and to whom. This is true of Confederate monuments put up in the Jim Crow era, and it is true of Drake. Enthusiasm for Sir Francis Drake was a phenomenon of the late 19th and 20th centuries. It is deeply entwined with Anglo-Saxonism, but Drake enthusiasts have always sought to tie the monuments to actual 16th century events. Drake has remained a frustrating man to pin down. He landed somewhere along the Pacific coast, most likely within a day's sail of the Farallon Islands, just offshore from the Golden Gate, but the details of his stay on the coast are confusing, contradictory, and often unlikely. Drake saw snow just north of San Francisco Bay, in June. Granted, this was the Little Ice Age, and extreme weather with a prolonged drought took place during those years, but still, snow in June? He claimed there were signs of gold and silver everywhere. He described animals no one can conclusively identify. Whole volumes have been devoted to deciphering a few pages worth of dubious information. But then, Drake may not have claimed these things at all, since the accounts of his voyage are from other hands. The Queen confiscated the log and the illustrated journal and suppressed both of them. Drake pictured as well as recorded what he saw, but the pictures and writings are lost. In California, Drake encountered people whom he did not understand. He could not translate their language, and he almost certainly failed to comprehend their actions. These difficulties were the commonplace events of exploration. But whenever the accounts should have been uncertain, they were certain, and most of the time they were probably wrong. Drake and his men thought the Indians in that area regarded them as gods and could not be persuaded to the contrary. The Indians were understandably confused about who or what Drake and his crew were. But since Coyote arrived from the Western Sea and the dead departed over the Western Sea, they may have believed that Drake and his men were the returning dead. In the 1940s, Robert Heiser, a leading California anthropologist who may have been the most sensible academic to get sucked into the Drake controversy, presented a good case for why the Indians were Coast Miwoks, with perhaps some Pomos among them, and why they thought the English were either ghosts or the walking dead. Parts of the accounts collected from the Indians fit some of what we know about later Miwok culture. The stories give a recognizable description of Miwok houses. Digged round about with earth, with clifts of wood set upon them, joining close together at the top like a spire steeple. They described the women as wearing garments made from bulrushes and cloaks of deerskin. Accounts of Indian baskets included the distinctive decorations typical of later Miwok and Pomo baskets. They record words, some of them unidentifiable, but others that might correspond to Miwok words collected hundreds of years later in the area around San Francisco Bay. And the lengthiest account, The World Encompassed, describes extraordinary behavior that corresponds to later Miwok mourning behavior. They acted, as the chronicler puts it, as men ravished in their minds. When they left the English camp, they began to lament, extending their voices in a most miserable and doleful manner of shrieking. When they returned 2 days later, the men gave gifts, and the women cried and shrieked piteously, tore their cheeks with their fingernails until the blood flowed, tore off the cloaks they wore, and holding their hands high, cast themselves on the ground with great violence, regardless of consequences. They watched the English psalm singing with great interest, recognizing it as a ritual even if they did not know the ritual's purpose. When the Indians left the English fort, they gave back all the gifts the English had presented to them. The Indians' behavior mirrored that of later Miwok. They both mourned the dead and feared their ghosts. When the English departed, the Indians burned a sacrifice of shell beads and feathers. The burning of beads to honor the dead was a practice of both later Miwok and Pomo. The moaning, cutting, and sacrifices all indicate that the Indians thought the English were returning spirits of the dead. Except for a ceremony with the young Englishman, they avoided touching the English, believing that physical contact with the dead would bring misfortune. One phrase the English heard and remembered, apparently because they heard it so often, was Nacharo Mu, meaning touch me not, or in later Miwok, Notketo Mu, keep away. The phrase may very well have been a response to the insistent lust of English sailors. Miwok women had no desire to lie with the dead. Amid all this strangeness and misunderstanding, simple human moments also took place. The Miwoks greatly enjoyed hearing the English sing. They would gather and ask these psalm-singing pirate-slash-privateers to perform for them. Drake's final piece of confusion led to the creation of the first European historical marker in the present United States, one that eventually eclipsed the crosses, great and small. A leading man among the Miwoks came with a large retinue, and the English thought him a king. The king, in turn, recognized Drake as the leader, the Hayo of the English. He showered Drake with gifts and placed a feathered crown on Drake's head and a shell bead necklace around his neck. The English interpreted this as the Indians acknowledging Drake as their king and sovereign, and, following the analogy to the end, imagined the Indian king bestowing his country upon Drake. Drake commemorated the imagined session by setting up a monument. Before we went from thence, our general caused to be set up a monument of our being there, as also of Her Majesty's and successors' right and title to that kingdom, namely, a plate of brass, fast nailed to a great and firm post, whereupon is engraved Her Grace's name and the day and year of our arrival there, and the free giving up of the province and kingdom, both by the king and people, into Her Majesty's hands, together with Her Highness' picture and arms in a piece of sixpence current English money, showing itself by a hole made of purpose through the plate, underneath was likewise engraven the name of our general, etc. The anonymous narrative described the plate as lead with a less elaborate inscription. At this place, Drake set up a great post and nailed thereon a 6D, a 6D being 6 denarii, the standard abbreviation of pence, which the country people worshipped as if it had been God. Also, he nailed upon this post a plate of lead, and scratched therein the Queen's name. And then Drake, his crew, or at least most of them, and three slaves they had captured from the Spanish, boarded the Golden Hind, abandoning a smaller ship that his cousin testified Drake had seized from the Spanish off the coast of Nicaragua. They supposedly sailed out of the estuary, into what would be Drake's Bay, and away. Chapter 3 Drake's Plate, Finding Drake. The headlands are above Drake's Estero. We walked here on the way back to the cove to see the estuary from above. The photograph records what we saw. Grass, scrub, sea, sky, and fog. The sea and the sky often seem to merge at Point Reyes. The photograph seems timeless. On any day across many centuries, the place would look like this. But it also records an absence. Drake left a plate nailed to a post above where it was that he landed. Although the Drake Navigators Guild erected its own post at the cove, there was never a sign of the original plate or post. A generation of Drake enthusiasts elaborately explained why. The story of the 1936 discovery of the plate, 5 by 8 inches in size and made of brass, begins like a fairy tale. A young clerk in a store in Oakland, while picnicking in Marin County about 6 months ago, found an old blackened piece of metal, which seemed to him curious. He originally intended to use it to patch the frame of his car. The clerk was not alone. He was with a girl, apparently a chance pickup acquaintance of the day, whom he refused to identify. He seemed a little ashamed of that part of the affair. This meant that his was the only account of the discovery. A friend advised him to take the metal plate to a famous historian, or at least as famous as historians get to be, Dr. Herbert Bolton at Berkeley, who was the leading scholar of Spanish America. Dr. Bolton immediately recognized it as the plaque which Drake set upon a post as shown in his accounts of the voyage. Bolton and Alan Chickering, then head of the California Historical Society, set about raising money to buy the plate. The fairy tale soon morphed into a detective story. Trying to sniff
out. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.